Good morning. Welcome to Cedar Creek this morning. I'm glad to see you all here. Glad that you braved the slick roads. Come and worship together our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To open our service this morning, I'll ask you to take out your bulletins with me and turn to the back for our scripture reading. I'll ask you to stand with me as we read this responsively. I'll read the black print and you all can respond with the red print. Psalm chapter 66, verses 1 through 5 and 16 through 20. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. All the earth worships you and sings praises to you. They sing praises to your name.
Come and see what God has done. He is awesome in his deeds for the children of man. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell what he has done for my soul.
I cried to him with my mouth, and high praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly, God has listened. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Amen. I'll ask you to remain standing for our first hymn this morning, hymn number 17 in your hymn books, Ye Servants of God. Amen. Excellent singing this morning. Our next hymn is an insert in your bulletin, Wonderful, Merciful Savior. And I'll ask you to remain standing if able for this.
Thank you.
You may be seated.
Well, we are so glad that you have joined us together this morning for worship. Trust that the service has already been a blessing to you this morning. Couple things to make us aware of this morning. We want to be in prayer for the Peek family. Chris Peek's father passed away this morning. The family was able to gather around. A lot of them were able to be together. Larry and Chris were on their way to be with him this morning and didn't quite make it, apparently, before he passed. But we're wanting to pray for the Lord's grace in that situation, and we're thankful that he had a salvation testimony. And that certainly gives Larry and Chris comfort during this time. We're going to be praying this morning for Judy Root. Many of you received the update on the prayer cord that they're going to be following up on a CT scan with a PET scan and possibly a lung biopsy. And that's a concern because she does have a history, as many of you know, of lung cancer. And so we want to be praying for wisdom and direction and good treatment for her in regard to that. We're also going to be praying this morning for Don Sleeman. He's been having a variety of issues in recent days, but at this point he finds himself in Pennock, and they're not really sure what's going on, but it looks like maybe they're going to be running some tests to see if there's something that's going to need their attention. So we're going to be praying for him this morning as well. Many of you have come to know Paul Vogler through the years, and he did pass away recently. And for those who may be interested in the information about his funeral, that funeral is going to be held at Grace Bible Church in Elkhart, Indiana. And that's going to be at 5 p.m. on Sunday, January 29th, so a week from today, down at Grace Bible Church in Elkhart, Indiana. He will have an interment at Fort Custer Cemetery. And so that will be happening at a later date, and that may be something that is perhaps more attainable for those of us who are still here in Delton. I'm also going to be praying today in line with the National Sanctity of Human Life Day. We have set this aside as a day for us to consider the priority, the sanctity of human life, not because of any self-obsession on our part, but because we believe that God has implanted within humankind his image and the value and the significance that goes along with that. And we want our culture to increasingly, as we have opportunity to influence it, to value and esteem and protect life in every phase of its existence, including the life of the unborn. And so we, of course, are finding ourselves in Michigan in a situation where it feels like we're not making much headway, but we can still certainly be grateful for the things that the Lord is doing in line with that cause. We're certainly grateful for the overthrow of Roe v. Wade that took place last year. But we're going to be praying with that in mind specifically this morning as well. Would you join with me as we go before the Lord at this time? Our Heavenly Father, it is a joy for us to be able to sing your praises, to consider all that you have done in our lives, and to strive to give you the honor and the praise that you deserve for that. We thank you for the encouragement that it is to gather together with your people. And even as we find ourselves meeting on a day where we are experiencing a little bit more weather than we have in recent weeks, and maybe not everyone has been able to make it out this morning, we're still encouraged at the people that have been able to come. And we ask that you might uplift our hearts, that you might encourage us with truth from your word, that you might convict us where that is needed, where there are changes that are necessary in our life, that as we worship you, we would not do so hypocritically, not expecting to change anything in our hearts or in our life, but that we would be submissive to the leading of your Holy Spirit and responsive to his working as we go through this hour this morning. Father, we thank you this day for the progress that has been made in our nation in regard to the sanctity of human life. Even just last year, we think about the incredible achievement that was the overthrow of Roe. We thank you for that grace that you have given to us as a nation. We thank you for the hearts that you have opened to the truth of that issue, and we thank you for the cause that is continuing to go forward in many places in our nation. At the same time, Father, we recognize that there is still more work to be done. We recognize, we acknowledge to you that the church all too often has been complacent and has not taken the firm stand that it should on a clear scriptural issue, and that oftentimes that's a reflection of a larger failure on our parts to value and esteem in human life as we should. All human beings are created in your image, and that does affect the way that we should treat that human life as we interact with it, in whatever form it takes around us. And so, Father, we pray that you would help us as your people to stand firmly upon the truth of your word, that we would have conviction and boldness in the face of a culture that oftentimes opposes the truths of your word and biblical morality. We pray, Father, that you would help our own state to come around increasingly on this issue, that you might change hearts, that you might change minds, that those who are investing themselves specifically into this cause would find their hearts encouraged, and that they might see people continually coming around to the perspective that would honor you and that would value the premium that you have placed on human life in our culture. Father, we pray this morning for those in our church family who are struggling. We ask for encouragement this morning for Chuck and Judy Root. We ask that you would give them good direction and treatment in response to what may have come up on this CT scan, and we pray that you would anchor their hearts and their faith and their trust in you and your provision for them. We pray for the Peak family as they are mourning the loss of Larry Jansen. We ask that you would give them great joy in his eternal hope, and we pray that you might bring them close together as a family to encourage one another at this time, and we ask that you would bring good from this situation, drawing people close to each other and drawing them close to Christ during this time. We also pray for your grace for Don Sleeman today as he's at Pennock. We ask that he would receive good care, that they would be able to find answers for the things that he's struggling with this day, and that you might cause him to know your presence in a very real way with him during this time. Father, this morning we are also mindful of our Tri-M missionaries, John and Johnny McGinnis. We ask that you might empower them in their work as the director of Tri-M. We ask that you would give them safety as they travel in this upcoming year. We ask that you would give them good opportunities for teaching and for continuing that work of discipleship and training up leaders around the world through that ministry of Tri-M. We pray that you would give them a blessed and fruitful year as they engage in that work. We pray your blessing now on this offering as we give. We pray that you would help us to give with cheerful hearts for your glory, and we ask that you would use what we give to build your kingdom and to accomplish your work in our church, in our community, and around the world. And we ask that in all things Jesus Christ might be praised, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Berkeys. Our last hymn this morning will be hymn number 66 in your hymn books, To God Be the Glory. I'll ask you to stand with me as we sing, and the junior church will be dismissed after the special music this morning. So junior church will stay in here with us until after the special music. Thank you for your singing. You may be seated.
Once again, this morning we find ourselves in Proverbs chapter 1, so I'll invite you to turn there in your Bibles as we get started. I think most of us are aware that the path we take in life, the decisions that we make along life's road, makes a world of difference in our destination. And the Bible often speaks of life as a path, as a journey, as a road. And other people have recognized the aptness of that comparison. One of my favorite poets, probably a poet that you encountered back in your high school days, is Robert Frost. And he described the impact of seemingly small choices in our lives in one of his very well-known poems, The Road Not Taken. Perhaps you remember encountering that at some point in your school days. And he concluded this poem, which was about making a decision, reaching a fork in the path, and deciding which way to go. And at the conclusion, he says, "I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference." That was his conclusion. And I think that you're left to wonder as you read that poem, did it make his life turn out for the better or for the worse? Was there one path that was actually better than the other? Or would the other one have actually been just about the same? There's some lack of clarity or absolute certainty about that poem. But there's something about it that resonates with us because we all know that there are decision points in our lives. There are moments when we make a choice that is going to have ramifications for us long down the road. And we don't always know which of those decision points are going to have that kind of lifelong impact. But sometimes we can trace the arc of our lives back to one crucial decision point. And that's especially true, I think, when those decisions that we're making are moral or spiritual in nature. So if you made the decision at a point in your life to put your faith and trust in Christ as your Savior, has that changed the direction and the trajectory of your life? It should. That's the way the Bible describes salvation, right? Conversely, the same thing is true if you find yourself confronted with the gospel and you decide, you know what? That's great for you, but that isn't for me. That is another decision that can be made in response to being confronted with that truth. And people make that decision and it does set them on a life path. And so that's why it's so important for you and me to give careful attention to the decisions we make in life, because one decision can have a great impact. And those decisions are multiplied day after day, year after year. Every decision that you make in your life, especially if it has some sort of spiritual consequence, is putting you on a spiritual path. And you can be on a direction of increasing Christ-likeness. You can be moving on a path of greater blessing from God, or you can be moving in a path of rebellion against him. And that is why it is so important that we pursue wisdom from the earliest years of our lives. Last year, we saw our first fatherly lecture in the book of Proverbs. And do you remember what it was that the father of Proverbs was warning his son about? There was a particular source of temptation that he wanted his son not to give into. What was it? It's the temptation of the gang, right? It's the lure of these sinful young people who are going to draw you in with them and say, you know what? If you cast in your lot with us, you're going to get all sorts of good things. And of course, the reality is that you know how that kind of lifestyle turns out. You understand that that's not going to be a good idea. But for the right kind of young person, that seems like a really good idea. And at the end of that first fatherly lecture, we're introduced to a character that you and I are going to see oftentimes repeatedly throughout the book of Proverbs. So I'll begin our time together this morning by looking at Proverbs 1 and verse 20. Concluding that fatherly lecture, we see that the character Wisdom is crying aloud in the street. In the markets, she raises her voice. Where do you expect to find the gang? You know, I hate to stereotype, right? But you often expect there to be more gang activity in a metropolitan area. That's where you are able to get in with a crowd like that and get away with things like that. There's a character that we haven't encountered very much in our study of this book yet, the prostitute, the foolish woman. Where would you expect to encounter her? Perhaps in the city. I'm not saying that you don't have to be on your guard out in the country. There are always temptations. But you would expect that maybe the city would be a place of temptation for a young person. And yet, who else is there in the city? Wisdom is there in the city. Wherever you are confronted with temptation, there is an alternative. And that alternative is wisdom. And so that is what Solomon wants his son to see, is the contrast. That is the alternative to giving in to the temptation of the gang. There is this character of wisdom who has so much more to offer than that gang is going to be able to give him. Now, I think you're going to notice as we work through our passage this morning that what wisdom has to say is pretty negative. This is not necessarily an uplifting speech that wisdom is going to give. If anything, it almost comes across as sort of fire and brimstone. Now, maybe you really connect with that sort of preaching. A lot of people feel uncomfortable with fire and brimstone preaching, I think especially these days. But the reality is that we need to be warned, and we need to take God's warnings seriously. There are grave consequences to pursuing a lifestyle and a path of sin. And wisdom is going to come right out of the gates by saying, if you do not pursue me, if you do not listen to what I have to say, there are going to be great consequences. I think we're going to see in today's passage that wisdom isn't really focused here on whether or not foolish choices can be forgiven. Now, can foolish choices be forgiven? Absolutely. Do foolish choices have consequences? Absolutely. And it is the consequences that wisdom is here to make us aware of this morning. Wisdom is interested in whether or not you can avoid the consequences of foolish decisions. And it's going to come out and say very clearly, you cannot avoid those consequences. As it has often been said, you can choose your actions, you can't choose your consequences. We get to choose our actions, but we cannot choose our consequences. So let's go ahead and dive into this passage. We're going to start off in verses 20 and 21 with the reality of wisdom's availability. Even in the place where you might expect to find any temptation you could look for, wisdom is there as an alternative. Wisdom cries aloud in the street. In the markets, she raises her voice. At the head of the noisy streets, she cries out. At the entrance of the city gates, she speaks. Now, as we confront this personification of wisdom, I do think it's important for us to decide at the beginning of the book of Proverbs how we're going to view this person. There are interpreters of the book of Proverbs who have seen wisdom as the person of Jesus Christ. That is one way that the book of Proverbs is consistently interpreted. And the New Testament does make it clear that in Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, right? And so it is very clear that there's a close connection between wisdom and Jesus Christ. But as I read what the book of Proverbs has to say about wisdom, it seems to me that wisdom is being used as a personification. I don't think that everything that is said of wisdom is necessarily being made as a point about the person Jesus Christ. But I do think that there is going to be very close overlap between wisdom and Jesus Christ, because Jesus is truly the wisdom of God to us. So that's the way that I'm going to interpret this as we go through here. I don't think that when you go to the city, you are necessarily going to encounter a person whose name is Wisdom. But wisdom is there nevertheless, and we ought to have ears to catch what it is that she has to say. Who is this wisdom for? Well, apparently it's for people who are in the city. We're going to get to see more specifically who that's for in verse 22, but I see right away that this is not something that is hidden. This is not something that you need to go to the Himalayan mountains to discover, right? This is not something that you need to find a person living in a remote cave in order to discover. Wisdom is there. It is available for anyone who is willing to find and listen to that. Wisdom is available for everyone, even in what can be the place of temptation. And you notice that wisdom is not only present, wisdom is shouting. I find myself thinking that sometimes when I look at news headlines. When I look at the kinds of things that are going on in our world, it seems to me that people ought to be directed to what God has to say in his word. It ought to be so easy for us to see that God's way is better than the way of this world. When you see the sinful things people are doing, when you see the consequences of people's sinful actions, it should be an obvious thing. But the reason why we often are insensitive to the calls of wisdom, of course, is that we are not wanting to listen to what wisdom has to say. And that brings us to the offer that wisdom actually makes. This is a public offer. She's shouting at the top of her lungs. And then what is it she's shouting? Verse 22, "How long, O simple ones, will you love being simple? How long will scoffers delight in their scoffing and fools hate knowledge?" Do you sense any frustration there? Yeah, I sense the frustration of a parent who is trying to train a child that absolutely will not listen to anything they have to say. I sense the frustration of a teacher who is trying to convey knowledge, trying to convey wisdom for life, and the student absolutely wants nothing to do with that wisdom. This personification of wisdom is bringing out the fact that this, even though wisdom is available, people don't want the wisdom that is there for them. And the people that she's offering this to are simple people. They are scoffers. They are fools. And because they are simple, because they are scoffers, because they are fools, they delight in being simple, they delight in scoffing, and they hate knowledge. Why would anyone hate knowledge? Does that make any sense? People do, right? Perhaps you have been that person at some point in your life when you are given wisdom that could change your life, it could change the direction of your life, and yet you just don't want to hear it because, after all, it would require you to do things that you don't want to do. People do respond this way, unfortunately, to wisdom. But does it have to be that way? Well, look at verse 23. "If you turn at my reproof, behold, I will pour out my spirit to you. I will make my words known to you." So who is wisdom for? It's not ultimately for people who've got it all figured out. It's not for people who already have their lives all put together, right? Wisdom is for simple ones, for scoffers, for fools, if they will turn at wisdom's reproof. If they will listen to what wisdom has to say, then that wisdom is there to benefit them. And that goes to a larger truth about Christianity that I think people who don't have a lot of exposure to a good, solid church often don't realize. I think there's a perception in our culture that Christians think that they're better than everyone else, that we are more deserving of God's grace and God's blessing than everybody else, and we just really think that everyone else is worse than we are. That's not a Christian way to look at the world, and that's not a Christian way to view ourselves. We say, along with the Apostle Paul, "I am the chief of sinners." That's our perspective. That is what we see in ourselves. But we have been given a great salvation. We have been given the privilege of a relationship with God. And by God's grace, using the wording of verse 23, we turned, right? That's the idea of repentance, that you turn and that you acknowledge the truth of God. And the same thing is true as we're thinking about this matter of wisdom. You can have made mistake after mistake after mistake in your life up until today, but you can start making the right choices today, can't you? You can turn and you can start paying attention. And I trust that maybe there would be somebody in the room this morning that would be confronted with that hope, that there is the opportunity to make a wise decision going forward and to change the trajectory of your life, and that you would answer that call and that you would turn at the reproof of wisdom. The issue here, of course, is not that wisdom is not available. It is not that wisdom is not powerful. The issue is not even really just the indifference or immaturity of the people who are there. It's that people love being simple. They love scoffing. They hate knowledge. And that is what we have to turn against. Because there is great danger for those who continue down that path. And we have the warning of wisdom then beginning in verse 24. Wisdom goes on to say, "Because I have called and you refused to listen, have stretched out my hand and no one has heeded. Because you have ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof, I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when terror strikes you. When terror strikes you like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you." That's pretty brutal, isn't it? You know, you would expect that wisdom as the personification of attributes that we connect with Christ, that wisdom would be compassionate, that wisdom would recognize people who are hurting, even if they've made foolish decisions that have taken them places they didn't think they would go. But I think what's going on here is wisdom is acknowledging that you can get yourself in a position where you have so messed things up that there is not a solution to extricate yourself from that. That is a very real possibility. And you could think of Bible characters who might illustrate that point. I wonder, for example, if Solomon ever spoke to his sons about the story of Saul. Would you imagine that he did? Would you imagine that Solomon ever talked about Saul to his kids? I would think he would. After all, Saul was only the king just before his father David, right? And what happened to Saul? Saul rebelled against the Lord, and the Lord removed him from his position as king in Israel. He made a series of wrong decisions, which he never truly repented of, and by the end of all that, he's just looking for any solution. He'll even go talk to a witch, and he cannot find what he is looking for. There is no deliverance because he has so messed himself up that he cannot hear God, and he is looking in places that are ultimately not going to give him the answer or the solution that he's looking for. We considered a character like that as we were concluding our study of Matthew's gospel here a few months ago. You might recall the time that we spent considering the character of Judas. Judas, of course, seems to have had a heart that was never truly right with God, but I would imagine there was a time when he thought he was on the right track, but his motives were off. And he made wrong decisions, and he started making selfish decisions. He ended up actually being a thief. And from that point onward, it was only a matter of time until he actually betrayed the Messiah, the Son of God. The Bible is filled with stories of people like that, people who made a bad decision, and then another bad decision, and then finally they reached a point where they could not find it in themselves to do what was right, and they would not eventually end up experiencing God's forgiveness. So this is a dangerous thing. This is a serious reality that wisdom is calling out. Verse 26, I will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when terror strikes you. You can deny wisdom to a point where there's no longer a solution in wisdom to be found. You can say, now I'll start making the right decision. Now I realize I've messed my life up too bad, but it's too late. Wisdom is not going to solve the problem that you have gotten yourself into. I don't think that's heartlessness. I think that's an acknowledgement of the folly of sin and the judgment that is going to come, the consequences that are unavoidable for foolish decisions. Verse 28 goes on to say, then they will call upon me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but will not find me. I'm reminded of what sometimes happens in school when you're teaching, and you will have students who have absolutely no concern for their grade in the class for months. And then all of a sudden, they reach a point when they realize, oh no, my grade in this class is about to be set, and it's going on my transcript. And then what are they doing? Then they're coming to the teacher, and they're saying, hey, what can I do to bring my grade up? Give me extra credit work. I'll do anything to fix this problem. Well, the answer, of course, is you had opportunity to fix this problem for months, and you didn't take advantage of the opportunity to do that. And that is the way we as human beings often operate in this world. We put off making the right decision. We put off pursuing wisdom. And then we think somehow we're going to be able to make up for that lost ground. That just is not the way life in this world works. And Solomon wants us all to recognize that so that we prize the pursuit of wisdom right now, right here today. It's interesting to me the language that Solomon uses, that he puts in the mouth of this person of wisdom in verse 28, they will call upon me. They will seek me diligently. Sounds like they would deserve at least some credit for that, wouldn't it? But are they going to be able to find wisdom at that point in the game? Apparently not. Unteachable people don't realize the value of what they cut themselves off from until it's too late. I think that's why you and I as Christians, we should have an inherent interest in knowledge. We should value knowledge in this world. We should value wisdom. We should value an understanding of the way life works, even in the event that we don't immediately see the application of it. I, I, I'm often at pains to try to communicate this to my students that I teach in school. You know, you may not see the value of what you're learning right here, right now, but you might be well served to take on faith that your teachers have some awareness of the skills that might benefit you later on down the road. If you're a child, you might benefit from paying attention to what your parents think you need to know about life and the kind of character and the kind of skills that you're supposed to be developing. You shouldn't say, well, that's just stupid. I don't see why I would need to worry about that. Your parents might know a thing or two more about life than you do, and you ought to pay attention to that. I think that's just a principle for us to keep in mind as Christians. We don't always understand the value to be attained from wisdom until we begin to be in a place to experience the benefits of wisdom. Or we've gotten to the point where it's too late for us to find that wisdom, and now we find ourselves in trouble wishing we had behaved differently. Well, why is wisdom's warning so harsh? Verse 29 says, because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. Is the fear of the Lord a minor part of this equation that we're talking about this morning? This is foundational to biblical wisdom, right? If you go right back to the introduction of the book, you're probably on the same page that you're looking at right now. In verse 7 of chapter 1, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom instruction. We're told multiple times in the wisdom books of the Bible that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. If you choose not to fear the Lord, whatever you think you're doing in life, you are not pursuing biblical wisdom, and there will be consequences for that later on down the road. And if that's the case, then there are consequences that are going to come your way. Verse 30 says that they would have none of my counsel and despised all my reproof. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their way and have their fill of their own devices. Those choices come with their own appointed consequences, right? It's not that the government has to bring the law in and enforce those consequences. It's not that God has to bring down his supernatural judgment on somebody. The choices that they are making will in and of themselves be the judgment because their life will not work the way that they think it's going to do. Well, we're given in verses 32 and 33 a summary of the options that we have before us. Like I said at the beginning of the message, this is mostly a negative message, right? This is a warning about the seriousness of folly and failing to listen to the guidance of wisdom. But there is an alternative, and we don't want to lose sight of that. Verse 32 says, for the simple are killed by their turning away, and the complacency of fools destroys them. Verse 33, but whoever listens to me will dwell secure and will be at ease without dread of disaster. What is the end result of ignoring wisdom? It's destruction. What kind of destruction? Well, total destruction, right? The simple are killed by their turning away. It could be true in a temporal sense, right? People lose their physical life by making foolish decisions, but that can also be true in an eternal sense. If we are not open to the truth of the gospel, if we are not willing to listen to what God has to say about the condition of our souls, then we will find ourselves not only facing temporal destruction, we will find ourselves facing God's eternal destruction. But that isn't the way it has to be. There is an alternative. Whoever listens to me will dwell secure. Do you want to have a secure life? You know, there's not very much in this life that is secure, is there? In fact, people will often say that the only things that are certain in this life are death and taxes, right? And there's a sense in which, as I said several messages ago, we got to be careful about taking the principles of Proverbs and sort of extending that out to the point where we think that every single Christian who lives a wise life is going to live to be 100, is never going to be ill, is never going to experience hardship or adversity in life. The Bible accounts for some exceptions, right? We understand that if we read the rest of Scripture, even the rest of the wisdom books in the Bible, books like Job and Ecclesiastes. But as much as anyone can have security in this world, that security is going to come through pursuing wisdom and building your life on the principles of wisdom. People who are controlled by their passions, controlled by their evil desires, controlled by their flesh, they think that they're setting themselves up for a world of pleasure. But oftentimes you can see people living like this. You can see the consequences in this world. You see the wreckage of addictions, the wreckage of financial pressures, of broken relationships, of stress and anxiety that are left behind that kind of an approach to life. It gives a lie to that whole approach, that somehow you are more secure if you are living for your selfish, sinful desires rather than living according to God's wisdom. If you want security in this life, the best thing you can do is listen to what God has to say about how to order and prioritize your life. Well, as we conclude our consideration of the message of wisdom in this passage, it seems to me that wisdom is asking for several things from us. I'm going to give three that come to mind to me as I think about this passage. One is humility. You're not going to be able to benefit from wisdom unless you're able to admit that there are things that you don't know. That's hard for us, isn't it? We all like to be right. We all like to feel like we've got our lives under control. But we can't improve, we can't grow, we can't move in the right direction if we're not willing to admit that we may still have a thing or two to learn. And by the way, that's true whether you're 10 years old or whether you are 100 years old, right? There is more for us to learn. There are areas that we can improve in. But this is especially important for young people. You want to, as a young person, be humble. You want to admit that you don't have everything figured out, and you want to pay attention to what others have to teach you in life. Certainly when it comes to the Word of God, but also just when your parents are telling you about the way that life works, when your teachers are trying to explain skills that are going to be valuable to you later on in life. You want to be humble enough to acknowledge that you have things that you can learn and to acknowledge what you don't know. We have to start with humility in order to benefit from the teaching of wisdom. But then we also have to demonstrate teachability, right? We have to actually be willing to prize instruction. We have to listen when wisdom is speaking. We have to have the ability to learn, to pay attention, to actually change and live according to the wisdom that we know. And this is oftentimes something that I think gets missed when it comes to young people who are raised in the church. Because they've been given information, they have wisdom in that sense. If you ask them Bible questions, Bible trivia questions, they've got answers. They know more than a lot of the adults in the congregation do. But when it comes right down to it, there's no commitment in their heart that they are going to live according to that truth, right? We have to also have a teachability where we are actually making changes in our life, making decisions based on the truth that we know and based on the wisdom of God's word. If we're not doing that, we are not teachable, and we will not experience the benefits of wisdom. Lest we forget, Solomon was very wise. He did not always live out the wisdom that God gave to him. That could be a very real danger for us. And that brings us to a third thing that I think we have to take away from this passage, and that is responsibility, the will, the decision that we are going to live out the truth that we know. We are going to actually make the changes in our lives that wisdom dictates that we make. And I'll say once again, it is gloriously true that the father of the prodigal son is waiting for his prodigal son with open arms. He is ready to forgive. He is ready to restore. He is ready to accept that repentant son back into fellowship. There is forgiveness for those who sin and turn from that sin. So whatever your past mistakes, whatever your past failures, the right next choice is always repentance, right? Doesn't matter how far down the line you are. The next right thing for you to do is to repent and to do what is honoring to God. But the hope of God's forgiveness does not remove all the negative consequences for sin, does it? And in fact, oftentimes when we set up patterns of sinfulness in our lives, what we're gonna find is we actually become hard in our hearts. We become less sensitive to the working of God's Holy Spirit. And we may find ourselves in a position where we don't even have the desire to come back to God, even though we've already made a wreck of our lives. God's forgiveness is real, it is transformational, it is glorious, but it does not remove negative consequences for sin. And there is a kind of young person who thinks that he's going to be the exception, right? Everybody else, they're making bad decisions, but I can thread the needle. I can do what I want to do, not worry about serving God, and I can get what I want to out of this life without wrecking my life. That kind of young person, he thinks he's going to be the exception. He can pursue sin as far as he wants, and then once it gets too hot, Then he's going to pull back, and then he's going to come back to God and get what benefits God has to offer him instead. But that just isn't the way life works, is it? That's not a decision that you want to make. Every day, you and me find ourselves making choices that align with biblical wisdom or oppose it. Those choices are setting you on a path in life. And when you reach that real inflection point in your life, that big decision that's going to set you down one path or down another, you may find that you're already set up to make one decision or the other by the choices you've already been making, by the priorities you've already been demonstrating in your life. That means that now is the day to order your life according to God's wisdom. Today is the day to start making choices for God's glory that are pleasing to him. And where are you and I going to find that wisdom that we need so that we don't make an unfixable mess of our lives? Well, God gives us secondary sources of wisdom, right? Older people in the church, our teachers when we're in school, our parents when we're children, right? God gives us some sources of wisdom that we should be paying attention to. But remember, true wisdom is grounded in the fear of the Lord. It's about our relationship with him, which means we need to be looking at what God has to say about wisdom. I'm going to have us close out this morning with a look at Psalm 19. This is a beautiful description of what the word of God is to us if we are willing to pay attention to it, if we are willing to be instructed by it, and to receive the wisdom that it has to offer us. Psalm 19, and I'll begin reading in verse 7. Where do you get the wisdom that allows you to lead a secure life for God's glory, to avoid the pitfalls of the world? Psalm 19, verse 7. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. And that is true. And you can experience those blessings in your life if you will build your life on the principles of God's word. It's going to take effort. It's going to take making the right decisions day by day. But I'm here to tell you that will give you benefits and rewards far beyond what you can imagine. And I'm going to encourage you, start while you're young. You stand to benefit from this teaching so much if you will begin to live your life this way as a young person and then commit to living that way the rest of your life. So may God give us the grace to do that. I'd like us to conclude the service this morning by taking out our bulletins and singing a song that's on the insert. Thy word is like a garden, thinking about what you and I stand to benefit from with God's word. And I'll invite us to stand together as we sing this together, and I'll ask Wyatt to come and lead us as we conclude.
Father in heaven, we come into your presence seeking your wisdom, seeking your guidance, that we might know that you are watching over us and that you are the one that we need to please. And I thank you for it. And if there's someone here today that has not really trusted Christ as Savior, that they'll do that today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.